بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. The Islamic Propagation Office at Rabwa, www.islamhouse.com. It's pleased to present to you this lecture.
الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He's the only one worthy of praise. I seek His help, His guidance and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge in Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Al-Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets. For Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the court of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is the Sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Al-Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Al-Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is the best of your ability. Fear Allah and don't die unless you are Muslims. After this, I greet you all with the greeting of Al-Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. I'd like to welcome you all, inshallah, for a continuation of Sharh Riyad al-Salihin, explanation of the book Riyad al-Salihin. كتاب رياض الصالحين by Imam Nawawi رحمة الله عليه and the explanation is by Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih Al-Uthaymeen رحمة الله عليه and inshallah today we're going to have a new chapter which we're going to be discussing inshallah today and hopefully that we don't get ourselves with the recording that we try to focus on having a class and benefit from the knowledge inshallah. For those who have Riyad al-Salihin inshallah, this is volume number 2. Especially if you have the version that published by Dar es Salaam publication. And inshallah, today we're going to be dealing with chapter 210. Although that we had talked before a little bit concerning this chapter, but I'm going to start from the beginning so the recording of the class can be in one piece together inshallah. Again, for those who have Riyad al-Salihin, part 2, Dar es Salaam publication. And inshallah, this is going to be in page number 890. Again, this is chapter concerning Salat al-Jum'ah, inshallah. We start first with reading the hadith, and this is started with a verse from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. باب فضل يوم الجمعة. قال الله تعالى: فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. وش الزمين الإيه؟ Then when the Jum'ah Salah prayer is ended, you may disperse through the land and seek from the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by working, and remember Allah much that you may be successful. We stop here and we go to the explanation of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen rahmatullahi alayh, which is going to be in volume number 3 and page 263. باب فضل يوم الجمعة. قال الله تعالى: فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. قال المؤلف رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه رياض الصالحين: باب فضل الجمعة. The author of كتاب رياض الصالحين إمام النووي رحمة الله عليه, he had mentioned in his book concerning the chapter of the obligation and the virtues of يوم الجمعة. The author Imam al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayh, he had mentioned something about the speciality of يوم الجمعة. ويوم الجمعة هو اليوم الذي بين الخميس والسبت. He said يوم الجمعة is the day which is between Thursday and Saturday. This day which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given specially to this ummah, the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. While the Yahud and Nasara, they went astray from it. That means they missed it. They did not know which one is the special day and the day which has all this speciality and all this reward and all this blessing. The Jews had utilized and selected the day of Sabbath, which is Saturday, what they call it the Sabbath. While the Nasara, the Christian, had selected the day of Al-Ahad, Yawmul Ahad, Sunday. Although these nations came before us and we came after them, but in the order of the days, that Friday comes first. So they came before us, but since we did the right selection and we chose Friday, Allah has guided us to Friday, so now we are ahead of them. فَكَانُوا تَبَعًا لَنَا. So they became a follower for us, although they had preceded us. And this one of the speciality which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given to this ummah, the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we're grateful and thankful, and we should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to this day which is Friday. The Shaykh Muhammad bin Salih al-Uthaymeen rahmatullahi alayhi is saying that يوم السبت, the Saturday and the Sunday, they have no speciality in them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has misguided the Jews and the Christians from the special day which is Jum'ah. So it became for us. So all praise is due to Allah. يوم الجمعة has خصائص, has a speciality. One among the best scholars who had mentioned and talked in details about it is Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi in his book called Zad al-Mi'ad. For those who want to know more about يوم الجمعه, let them to check this book Zad al-Mi'ad, which is the revision of the Day of Judgment. After this, the muallif, the author, Imam al-Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, he started his chapter with the verse from Surah Al-Jum'ah, verse number 10. فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. لك الله سبحانه وتعالى ستيتد. So when is the prayer is over, يوم الجمعة, the Friday prayer, disperse in the earth, go to your business, وابتغوا من فضل الله, and seek from the bounty of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And remember Allah سبحانه وتعالى a lot, so you can be successful. So the success in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remembering Allah is the means and the way to success. Before this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض وابتغوا من فضل الله واذكروا الله كثيرا لعلكم تفلحون. Which is the meaning is, O who you believe, when is the Adhan is called for Jum'ah, in the day of Jum'ah, hasten to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and leave alone all kind of occupation. Buying, selling, business, school, office, whatever it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, leave it alone. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Indeed, this is better for you if you only knew. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called in us with the term and the title of the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command us to leave all kind of occupation alone in that time. And this what is talking about an-nida'i thani. That means the adhan when is the imam will go in the member. This is called the second adhan. Amma an-nida'u al-awwal, as for the first adhan, which Uthman ibn Affan, may Allah be pleased with him, he had initiated this adhan. He had started this adhan in Al-Madina because the Muslim community became larger than the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the other Khulafa al-Rashideen. As a result of this, Amir al-Mu'mineen in the time Uthman ibn Affan, he commanded for a first adhan before the time of Jum'ah to be called by the marketplace so the people can prepare and get ready for Jum'ah. So this became from the sunnah of one of the members of the four Khalifa whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us to follow their sunnah by saying عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي. Indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had stated an order and command us to follow his sunnah and the sunnah of the righteous guided Khalifa who came after him. Indeed, this is a misguidance. Some people to call the first adhan to be innovation. How you can claim that one of the Sahaba and one of the Khulafa al-Rashideen making a bid'ah? I say to you, that means Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahmatullah alayhi say, I will say to you, you are the one who are mubtadi' and you are the one who acting on bid'ah. How do you call it? How you dare to call it bid'ah? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, those are al-khulafa' al-rashideen, the guided, rightly guided Khalifa. Those people, although they may be old in the age, but their mind is like the children. How you talk about the Sahaba and one of the leaders of the Sahaba that he's committing bid'ah? And you say to you the one who know about the Sunnah, you are the one who saying bid'ah by saying this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, O you believe, When the Adhan is proclaimed for Jum'ah, helping to the remembrance of Allah. What been meant in this verse by the remembrance of Allah is Al-Khutbah and the Salah. As for the Khutbah, because the Imam, he will make the Tashahud. And he will say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. This is the remembrance of Allah. And also in the Salah, that you will make a Tashahud. When you sit and say, التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. So the remembrance of Allah is in the khutbah and in the salah. Also the Imam in the khutbah, he will remind the believers about different things related to their deen and give them advice, and this also from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ, leave all kind of occupation alone, leave it alone. Therefore, when the adhan is called for Jum'ah, business is haram, earning money is haram, unless you are one of those who are exempted from Jum'ah, like women as example. So if a woman buy or sell during Jum'ah, this is acceptable because she is not one of the people whom Allah has commanded to make Jum'ah. If you and your Muslim brother walking together and you hear the adhan going in your way, going to the mosque, and while you walk and you discuss a business deal, and you agree about it, this action and this transaction is not Islamically, is not right. You could not act upon it because you conducted a business agreement during the time which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbid for you to indulge in it. And this will become batil. وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ نَهَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُ فَهُوَ بَاطِلٍ لِقَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كل شرط ليس في كتاب الله فهو باطل. Your agreement and your transaction is invalid because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, any transaction, any condition, any agreement which is not in the book of Allah, that means is not with agreement of the law of Allah, it will be invalid. Invalid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله. This means, oh you believe, when the adhan is called for salah in the day of Jum'ah, hasten to the remembrance of Allah. This addressing for the traveler, the one who is home, anybody who hears the adhan, it became incumbent upon him to go to Jum'ah. That because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he called in us with the name of believers. Say, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So who exempt you from such addressing? If somebody will say, I'm a traveler, we ask him simple question, are you a believer? He say, بَلَى, of course, indeed, I am a believer. So we say to him, listen to the statement of Allah. He's saying, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله ذلك وذروا البيع ذلكم خير لكم. يعني خير لكم من البيع, i.e. that the salah and listening to the khutbah is better for you than buying and selling. That because when you go to Jum'ah, you are establishing the ruling of Allah and the deen of Allah. So this much better establishing the deen than making money and transaction. If you are one of those who have the knowledge, so you have to understand that going to Jum'ah and leaving all kind of occupation is much better for you than indulging in any transaction. الله سبحانه وتعالى استيفت فإذا قضيت الصلاة فانتشروا في الأرض. If the salah is over, disperse in the earth and seek from the bounty of Allah. But even after the salah, indulging in the buying and the selling, don't let this beguile you from the remembrance of Allah. And he's saying, وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. That means, remember Allah a lot. I.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, don't think because you finish the khutbah and the salah and the remembrance of Allah. So don't think by finish this that no more remembrance of Allah. But remember Allah in all cases, at all time, in your home, in your street, in every fashion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتِ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Indeed, in the creation of the heaven and the earth, and the alternation of the day and the night, is a sign for those who have mind to reflect. Who are those who أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ? Those one who are sensible one. Allah said, الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Who are the sensible one? Who are the reasonable one? Who are the good ones that have mind and sense? Allah describes them by saying, those who remember Allah in a standing position, sitting position, laying down on their side, reflecting in the creation of the heaven and the earth, and they will say, oh our Lord, indeed, you didn't create this for no purpose, not for vain. Glory be to you, so protect us from hellfire. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us that after the salah is finished, we are not obligated to remain in the mosque. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the salah is over, now go about your business. Seek from the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means if a person, he starts with his jum'ah, and he puts the jum'ah over the business, stop his business for the purpose of his salah and the khutbah, and after this he will go seeking from the bounty of Allah after Jum'ah, now you are free to go to seek from the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no khutbah, no speech, no admonishment, because what Allah legislates for us is enough, which is khutbah and salah. And this was the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ولهذا قال الإمام أحمد رحمة الله عليه إذا تكلم أحد بعد الصلاة فلا تستمع له إلا أن يكون كتابا من السلطان. إمام أحمد رحمة الله عليه said, if anybody starts to give a speech after خطبة الجمعة, after you already heard the khutbah, so there is no need for you to sit after this. If somebody gives a speech, you don't have to sit and listen to him. This is what Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah said. Only with exception that there is a letter or instruction been sent from the Amir, the head of the Islamic State. That's because anything coming from the head of the Islamic State, it is obligation on us for to listen and to obey, and whatever direction they given us according the deen, that we need to follow. As for somebody else giving khutbah after the khutbah and after the salah, no, this not the sunnah. This is not the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not give khutbah after a khutbah. We did not get this from hadith, neither authentic, neither weak. Some of the Muslims nowadays, it became like a tradition. After Jum'ah, they given another khutbah. After the Salah, they given another speech. Or maybe some of them even they do it before Jum'ah also. So by this, we made the khutbah to be three khutbah. From where you got this? This is not the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. So you can achieve success. You want success? How you go about success? By leaving the business alone. By leaving the business alone. This is the way it's supposed to be. Leave the business. Go to Jum'ah. Put the order of Allah before your personal desire. The Shaykh Rahmatullah alayhi is saying, you are not supposed even to buy anything, even a miswak. Because it's the habit that people, they want to go to Jum'ah. So now the Adhan is called, you could not even buy a toothbrush. Now let's go to some of the ahadith related to the Jum'ah, inshallah, as it came in the book of Imam al-Nawawi, rahmatullah alayhi. The first hadith, which is hadith number 1147. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خير يوم طلعت عليه الشمس يوم الجمعة فيه خلق آدم وفيه أدخل الجنة وفيه أخرج منها رواه مسلم. Narrated أبو هريرة, may Allah be pleased with him. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the best day in which the sun has ever risen is Friday. On that day, Adam was created. He was admitted to paradise and he was expelled from Jannah. This hadith in the collection of Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayh. قال الإمام النووي رحمة الله عليه في كتابه رياض الصالحين في باب فضل الجمعة شيخ محمد بن صالح العثيمين, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his soul with his mercy, saying, he's saying that شيخ الإمام النووي رحمة الله عليه mention حديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم which is in the collection of Imam Muslim that the best day that sun ever risen is Yawm al-Jum'ah. What we need to understand from this, now the explanation of Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen is saying, what you need to understand from this, that this is the best day in the weekday. We saying this so this not to be a contradiction with the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ يَوْمُ عَرَفَةٍ. Because there is another hadith which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, the best time that the sun rise, the best day is يَوْمُ عَرَفَةٍ, the day of Arafah during Hajj. Therefore, we say that each hadith is related to a special occasion. The first one talking about the best day among the week is Yawm al-Jum'ah. And the other one is talking about the best day among the whole year, which is the day of Arafah. That's because Yawm al-Arafah is the best day for the whole year. And Yawm al-Jum'ah is the best day among the whole week. In that day, in the day of Jum'ah, Allah created Adam. Adam is the father of all mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created him with his own hand. Allah had created him from dirt. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, Kun fakan, be, and he became. Allah created him in Yawm al-Jum'ah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him dwell in Jannah in the day of Jum'ah, which is Jannah al-Ma'wa, which the Jannah of refuge, which is the Jannah, all the human being will go to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted him in Jannah, him and his wife. And he said to them, اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة فكلا من حيث شئتما ولا تقربا هذه الشجرة فتكونا من الظالمين. Live and dwell in Jannah, you and your wife. Eat from any place that you want, you desire, and don't come near this tree. Otherwise, you be among the wrongdoer, the transgressor. So Allah permits them to eat from all the trees that in Jannah. And Allah forbids them from only one single specific tree, and this was a mean of a test for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَا الشَّيْطَانُ لِيُبْدِيَ لَهُمَا مَا وُورِيَ عَنْهُمَا مِنْ سَوْآتِهِمَا وَقَالَ مَا نَهَاكُمَا رَبُّكُمَا عَنْ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ إِلَّا أَنْ تَكُونَ مَلَكَيْنِ أَوْ تَكُونَ مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ وقاسمهما إني لكما لمن الناصحين فدلاهما بغرور فلما ذاق الشجرة بدت لهما سوآتهما وطفقا يخصفان عليهما من ورق الجنة. Which is the meaning is the shaitan had whispered to both of them, i.e. Adam and his wife, for purpose of exposing their private parts. And the shaitan or iblis said to them, the only reason Allah forbid you to eat from this tree, that because if you eat from it, you're going to turn to be angels, or you're going to live forever. This trick didn't work. So now he has to move to another stage. He said, I swear to you, I am advisor. I only think good for you. So he kept with them until he deceived them and made them curse the tree. Upon that, the private parts became exposed to them. And they start to collect them from the leaves of the trees of Jannah to cover their private parts. That's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sheathed the private parts from them. They could not see their own private parts. But when they disobey Allah, and when they ate from this tree, now the private parts became exposed to them. And Adam was able to see and look to his own private parts. And Hawa was able to look to her private parts. They became exposed by eating from the tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. And Adam had disobeyed his Lord and he gone astray. When they ate from it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands them to get out. So they ascended, they descended to the earth. And this one of Allah's wisdom. Because if Allah didn't plan it this way, no khaliqa, no bashariya, no human being will be on the earth. And this is a test. And this a wisdom of Allah سبحانه وتعالى was this had happened. But nothing happened in this life without the permission of Allah. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever he do anything, there is a wisdom behind it. There is a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making all these things happening. So look, how they been kicked out of Jannah and then sent down to the earth due to one single disobedience to Allah. What's the matter with us? We are disobeying Allah day and night. We ask Allah to forgive us. We build on a hope which is nothing but mirage. We hoping for Jannah and high degree in Jannah, although that we committing all this disobedience day and night, sometimes even when neglecting the obligation. And look how our hearts, some of us their hearts are full with hatred, envy, jealous. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. This Jannah, which Adam had came out of it, the scholars, some of them, they say, they are Jannah al-Ma'wa, the real Jannah, while others, they say, that is another Jannah here on the earth, which a lot of trees and good things. A nice breeze and water. But the correct opinion that this Jannah that Adam been kicked out of it is the Jannah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it Jannah al-Khuld. Fadal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all the things. This is some of the reward of Yawm al-Jum'ah that Allah created Adam in that day. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted Adam to enter Jannah in the day. And like I said, this is Allah's wisdom to create Adam, to make him enter Jannah, to make him come out of Jannah to the earth as a result of one single disobedience to him. But we have to understand that Adam had repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Him and his wife, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated, قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. They said, O Allah, indeed we had wronged our own soul, and if you don't forgive us and be mercy to us, we be doomed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ثُمَّ اجْتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ وَهَدَى. Indeed, after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had selected him and repent on him and guided him. So alhamdulillah, yes, Adam committed sin. Yes, he disobeyed his Lord, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him the ability to return, and he had given the guidance to ask for forgiveness, and Allah said that he forgave him, and he had repented on him, and he had guided him. So, listen very carefully to what the Shaykh is saying. Shaykh Muhammad ibn Uthaymeen rahmatullah alayh said, so Adam became, after his tawbah, much better than he was before. You see? That he became a better Muslim, a better Abdullah, when Allah had accepted his tawbah. He became much better than he was before. Let's go to the second hadith, inshaAllah, concerning Yawm al-Jum'ah. And this is page number 892 and this is hadith number 1148. وعنه أي أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من توضأ فأحسن الوضوء ثم أتى الجمعة فاستمع وأنصت غفر له ما بينه وبين الجمعة وزيادة ثلاثة أيام ومن مس الحصى فقد لغى رواه مسلم. Narrated أبو هريرة. Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if anyone performs ablution properly, then comes to Friday prayer, listens to the khutbah, the religious talk, attentively, and keeps silent, his minor sins between that Friday and the following Friday will be forgiven, with the addition of 3 more days. But he who touches people has caused an interruption. Next hadith. وعنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الصلوات الخمس والجمعة إلى الجمعة ورمضان إلى رمضان مكفرات ما بينهن إذا اجتنبت الكبائر رواه مسلم. Narrated أبو هريرة may Allah be pleased with him, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying the 5 prescribed daily prayer and the Friday to the next Friday and the fasting of Ramadan to the next Ramadan is expiation for the sins committed in between them as long as major sins are avoided. Next hadith 1150 وعنه, that mean again from Abu Huraira, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهم أنهما سمع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول على أعواد من بره لينتهين أقوام عن ودعهم الجمعات أو ليختمن الله على قلوبهم ثم ليكونن من الغافلين. Narrated ابن عمر and أبو هريرة may Allah be pleased with him, with them. We heard Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, while delivering khutbah on his wooden pulpit, either some people stop neglecting the Friday prayer, or Allah will set a seal upon their hearts, and they will be among the neglecting ones, the negligent ones. The next hadith, inshallah, and after this we go to the explanation. Hadith Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قال, إذا جاء أحدكم الجمعة فليغتسل متفق عليه. Narrated Ibn Umar, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when one of you intends to come for the Friday prayer, he should take a bath. Bukhari and Muslim. One hadith more, inshallah. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال غسل الجمعة غسل الجمعة غسل يوم الجمعة واجب على كل محتلم. Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, taking a bath before coming to Friday prayer is obligatory on every adult. وعن سمرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من توضأ يوم الجمعة فبها ونعمة ومن اغتسل فالغسل أفضل. رواه أبو داود والترمذي وقال حديث حسن. Narrated سمرة Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, It is all right to perform ablution properly for the Friday prayer, but it is better to take a bath. Now let's see what Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahmatullahi alayhi, is saying, explaining this ahadith. This ahadith related to the ruling of Jum'ah. Imam al-Nawawi, rahmatullahi alayhi, had mentioned it in his book Riyad al-Salihin, that a person, when he perform wudu in his house, and he will listen to the imam when he's given the khutbah until he finishes, this will be a forgiveness for his sin from the last Jum'ah to the present Jum'ah. But if somebody touches the people, now he violated this rule. The meaning that he will be deprived from the reward and the blessings of Jum'ah. And Jum'ah will be for him as if he prays Zuhr. That means he's not getting the full reward that's supposed to be getting out of attending Jum'ah. He will be free from the obligation, but no reward. And when he's talking about the people, that because the mask of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be covered by small stones, pebbles, similar to the ones that we use it while we stone the jamarat in Hajj. Small. So the masajid or the mosque in that time used to be carpeted with pebbles or with sand. So whosoever touches this pebble or anything that he will play, get busy, instead of listening to the khutbah, he will get busy like touching this pebble and play with it. He will be deprived from the reward of Jum'ah. As a result of this, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us, الَّذِي يَتَكَلَّمْ وَالْإِمَامُ يَخْطُبْ كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. The one who talks while the imam is giving the khutbah is similar, or his example, like a donkey. A donkey carrying the box in its back. The box has the knowledge, but the donkey could not read, so he could not benefit from these boxes that in its back. So when a person talks and the imam gives the khutbah, his example like the donkey carrying box. And also a person who may say to his Muslim brother, listen to the imam, to try to advise him, to correct him. No, it's not your job. Somebody's talking. Let the imam is the one who correct him. Don't say anything. Don't spoil your Jum'ah for somebody else. He's saying, وَالَّذِي يَقُولُ لَهُ أَنْصِتْ لَيْسَتْ لَهُ جُمْعَةٌ يُحْرَمْ أَجْرُ الْجُمْعَةِ. And if somebody say to his Muslim brother, pay attention to the khutbah, now he also been deprived from the reward of Jum'ah. We have two hadith, which one of them in the collection of Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi, say man tawadda, whosoever make ablution. But the hadith which reported by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, غسل الجمعة واجب على كل محتلم. Taking the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, is more information. So we are obligated to take the additional information, which is the obligation of taking ghusl for Yom Jum'ah. Although that hadith Abu Huraira talks only about ablution. Also, we have to keep in mind that hadith Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, which commanding us in it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to take a shower, this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim and Ahmad and Nasa'i, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah. So, seven of the muhaddithin, the scholars of these books, are narrator, while the one by Abu Huraira is only in the collection of Imam Muslim. As we understand from the ruling of the knowledge of hadith, that what is the seven scholars, the Imams of the hadith, had narrated is much stronger and should be taken in consideration more than one that's been narrated by Imam Muslim only, rahmatullahi alayh. The hadith, which is narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu anhu, Abu Sa'id, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the taking a bath a must upon a person who reached the age of puberty. When a person reaches the age of puberty, now he became mukallaf. That means he is obligated to carry the obligation of Islam. Therefore, now Sheikh Na'sami rahmatullah alayhi is saying, therefore we say that the scholars who went to the opinion of having a ghusl, a full bath, in the day of Jum'ah, a must upon every man, doesn't matter if a winter or summer, doesn't matter if your body dirty or clean, this will be deserving our attention more. That because the statement of Rasulullah s.a.w. is clear, and this was understood from the Sahaba, because Amir al-Mu'minin Uthman radiallahu anhu, he entered the mosque while Umar radiallahu anhu giving the khutbah, and Umar object. He said, Wallahi ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, by Allah, O Amir, the commander of faith, I didn't do anything except I rushed and made my wudu and I came right away. So first, Umar was objecting the delay of Uthman entering Jum'ah after the Adhan is called and the khutbah starts. He say, as soon as I hear the Adhan, all what I did, made wudu and I came right away. So now Umar said what? And only wudu? That means now, instead one problem, two problems. Number one, you come in late. And number two, you only made a wudu, you didn't take a shower. So this was objection from Umar. And the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, they were sitting there and they did not say to Umar anything. That means the Sahaba agreed, and this is the understanding of the Sahaba. And this is the way we say that we understand the deen by the understanding of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. So when the Sahaba agree about something, now it is incumbent of us to do it. Therefore we say, the most authentic opinion, that we have to take ghusl in Yawm al-Jum'ah. But the question here, what about if somebody didn't take a shower? Does it mean no Jum'ah for him? Does it mean that his Jum'ah is not acceptable? No. His Jum'ah is still acceptable. So in conclusion to our subject for today, although that we didn't finish the whole subject about Jum'ah, that you are obligated to make ghusl in Yawm al-Jum'ah, But this has nothing to do with the salah. If a person make only wudu and attend Jum'ah, Jum'ah is still acceptable, but you have violated a rule of the day of Jum'ah. We could not say that he loses his Jum'ah because he didn't make salah without tahara. Because even if the person have wudu, this ghusl is still obligation. So this is not a ghusl from janaba. If a person make a ghusl for Jum'ah and he have a ghusl for janaba, he didn't intend to have ghusl in janaba, this ghusl is not going to be sufficient. So ghusl Jum'ah is not a ghusl because you're dirty or impure or whatever. This is a special ghusl for Yawmul Jum'ah. So if somebody made only wudu, his Jum'ah is still acceptable, but he had lost the reward that he was supposed, or he had violated one of the rules of Yawmul Jum'ah. Inshallah, I apologize that we could not cover the whole subject today, but inshallah, Monday we'll try to cover the rest about Jum'ah.
In conclusion, we ask Allah that He brings you benefit through this lecture. For more information, you may contact us through the following address. The Islamic Propagation Office, Rabwa, P.O. Box 29465, Riyadh, 11457, Saudi Arabia. Phone 445-4900. Also 491-6065. Fax 497-0126. If you would like to listen to more beneficial lectures, feel free to visit our website at www.islamhouse.com. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.